You have arrived at your destination.
Hi, this is Gene Simmons from Kiss, and you're listening to Sean vs. Wild. And guess what? Now that you've heard this, you owe me $29.95. Go to kissonline.com. Boom.
All right, Wildlings, thank you for tuning in to America's second favorite podcast. And because America is the greatest country on earth, Earth's second favorite podcast by default, you know what I'm talking about, the Sean versus Wild podcast. I'm your host, as always, the man, the myth, the Sean Thriller Smith, the guy putting Rad back into talk radio. And it's time to rock and roll all night and podcast every Tuesday. That's right, guys. And hopefully you're having a great week. I say that every week because I mean it. I hope you're having a great week. And of course, I'm having a great week because I'm going to sit down here with an old friend of mine, somebody that I haven't talked to in got to be a decade. I'm talking to Ryan Davis. And I know you guys know Ryan Davis, probably from his work on Sophomore Lounge, his record label, Cropped Out Fest, his annual festival, his band State Champion. Or you probably remember Ryan, best of all, for throwing the sickest basement shows of all time. Ryan and I have been playing music together, started playing music together many years ago, and we got a decade's worth of catching up to do this week on the show. So I think you guys are really going to like that. A lot of great stuff coming down the pipeline there for Ryan. So if you don't have plans, now you do. October 5th and 6th is the 8th annual Cropped Out Fest. Yes, Cropped Out number 8, guys. Go down to American Turner's Field and make it happen. I will be there so we can sit down and have a beverage and talk about it and check out awesome bands and all the awesome stuff they got planned. You're going to hear all about it this week. And guys, yeah, of course I got to talk about my awesome sponsors, Audiophile Inc., audiophileinc.com. Shane from Audiophile Inc. is going to give you the best deal in town, no matter what town you live in. I've been saying it week in and week out. He's got you covered when it comes to your screen printing needs. All you have to do is go to audiophileinc.com, talk to Shane, tell him the Wild Man sent you, audiophileinc.com. Also, guys, I want to tell you about my amazing sponsor at Audible. You guys know Audible. It's an Amazon company. Just for listening to the Sean vs. Wild podcast, they're going to give you a free 30-day trial. And when you sign up for the free 30-day trial, it helps me. They're going to write me a check. They're going to deliver me a gigantic check, just like the ones that you see, like when people win big on The Price is Right for like Plinko and stuff, or whatever. I don't know, charities. Just wherever big checks are, you've seen them. That's what they're going to do. They're going to write me a huge check. And it's all because you signed up for a free 30-day trial of Audible. They have over 180,000 audiobooks for you to choose from. So you're guaranteed to get something you like. And if you don't like it, you can always exchange it for one that you know you're going to like. And then also, too, whether you keep the subscription going or not, you still get to keep the audiobook. Dude, that's a win, win, win. And I would appreciate that. And I'll appreciate the gigantic checks. So, guys, go to audibletrial.com/SeanVersusWild. And make it happen. Also, big shout out to Joe Brock, that guy working hard each and every week, booping dials, making me sound like $1 million. Joe, I appreciate all the work that you did on the show today. Guys, I appreciate you tuning in. Do me a favor, rate, review, subscribe to the podcast if you haven't already. Just go to iTunes, rate it 5 stars, give it a positive review, and make sure you hit the subscribe button. I'm snapping in the background for emphasis, guys. Rate, review, subscribe. I really appreciate it. And we're just going to keep building our numbers, man. Keep on building it up. The sky's the limit. We are the second greatest podcast on earth, the second greatest podcast in America. And we're going to be number one in your hearts. That's what's up, guys. I appreciate all the help. Enough from me. I'm just blabbering on. So here's my conversation right now with Ryan Davis. Tune in, turn up. Let's get wild. You got it right now.
Wild.
You know, on your way over here, I couldn't help but think that this interview would have been perfect had we done it maybe in your parents' basement.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Just relive the glory days of Two for Flinching.
The glory days have never stopped for me. I'm over there probably 3 days a week. My entire life I've lived in town.
So. Does your mom still make you sausage biscuits in the morning? Label?
Well, I've been basically vegetarian since probably 2005, so not still. But she does still put labels on everything. She does put little sticky notes
on. God bless her.
like extremely sharp. It's just extremely sharp, it'll say, on the knives.
Extremely sharp. My favorite was the sausage biscuits, and it'd just be like, cheese without cheese.
In case anyone's blind.
Yeah, in case you took a bite of it, and you're like, there's a missing ingredient here. I specifically ordered the ones with cheese.
Yeah.
But no, dude, I always thought your parents were so cool because they just like really... And we don't have to talk about your parents throughout the whole podcast, but I want to give them a big shout out because they were just like super like behind you when it came to like music and like having me and our other ragtag group of friends hang out in the basement and play music at any time. And then the basement shows.
Yeah, they're the best. I mean, it's always been like an open door over there, which I don't take for granted. I know a lot of people, you know, growing up, we're told that they shouldn't live out their crazy fantasies of making art and music and all these things. And I was lucky enough to have two parents that fully kind of pushed me to do so. So,
dude, one last story, and then we'll just get into actually talking about other things. But remember that time that your dad was really, really wanted you to watch the Sports Illustrated swimsuit?
I don't remember that. I had a feeling that whatever you said, it was going to be just some, like, because people are always like, this one time at your parents' house, and I'm like, I don't remember that at all, but I'm sure that happened.
We don't have to rehash all the glory days, but I remember your dad was like, Ryan, come down here. There's going to be girls in bikinis.
Maybe he thought I was gay or something.
I don't know, man.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know, but I do remember specifically you telling me that story where it was just like, Ryan, there's going to be girls in bikinis.
Man, now that you say that, I'm vaguely remembering that, but yeah, that's one of many many Gary-isms that are often celebrated.
Big shout out to Gary, man.
Love Gary, love Debbie. They're still doing well.
Good. They're not too far from me. I'll have to pop over there and...
Oh, they'd love to see. I think they might have even asked how you were doing at some point in the last couple of years.
Well, hopefully they'll be listening to the podcast.
Yeah, I'll send it their way.
Gary and Debbie, big shout out right at the top of the hour.
Big shout out right out the gates.
Right out the gates, dude.
It's all downhill from there.
Dude. But yeah, the basement, that's where all the magic happened. And I was also thinking, too, last night, just like how crazy it is, like the synchronicities of life and how randomly, like, you wanted to start a band and somehow you knew Travis and Jonathan and I was like playing.
I didn't, though.
Yeah,
I only knew Chris Linhart, and then he was like, I know these other guys, I'm going to bring them over. And I was like, cool. My parents have a basement, we can... bang on stuff and yell and bring him over and we'll see what happens.
But yeah, well, how crazy is it? Okay, so you knew Linhart, and I guess Linhart might have known Jonathan and Travis from like telecommunications class or something.
Yeah, from Jeff High. Yeah.
And the thing is like Jonathan and Travis and I had just been like playing music in my garage, but like no singer, playing like little covers and like just kind of learning how to play.
Yeah.
And then one day he's like, yeah, dude, do you want to go over there and jam? And I was like, okay. And I remember going over there and I was like, man, it'd be hilarious if I just wore like this FUBU jersey and these chains.
I forgot about that.
I thought it would be hilarious. Like, yeah, I'm just going to wear this FUBU jersey and these chains. Make people think I'm like real ghetto. But how crazy is that? Like, just like randomly one day, like this happens. And I feel like it changed the entire trajectory of my life.
I mean,
like,
here we are 15 years later.
Yeah.
Or probably like 20. Almost.
Well, let's see. I was in high school, or 15, 16 years.
But that was around 2002,
probably.
It would have been earlier than that, because I graduated high school in 2003.
Yeah. So, and I graduated in 04. So, probably around 2000.
It was the early 2000s, for sure.
But here we are, almost, I mean, might as well be 20 years later. But I feel like it changed the entire trajectory of my life. Like, I was, like, thinking, I was like, okay, well, if I hadn't done that, then I probably would never have met... like Wes and started all the other bands. And I definitely wouldn't have met Nick Dittmeyer and played in Blood Drive. And then from there, I wouldn't have, you know, done this or played Warped Tour or like done this or even had this podcast.
Yeah. And Dittmeyer was a huge for me too, because he kind of was starting to write country songs out of the punk scene. Like, he was kind of getting into this country folk thing at the same time that I sort of was. And we were both like, telling each other, like, it's okay to do that. You're like, you don't have to, like, always be screaming in every band.
So. You don't have to be so emotional and angry.
But yeah, like, just, I mean, going back to the basement again, it's like, not only the music stuff, but like, you know, Cutter Williams, who I'm still very close friends with, like, we would, you know, make those movies over there. We'd always be having band practice over there. We'd be like, just like, all the stuff that went down at that house and going, like, my first shows, you know, we threw shows over there for the first time. Like, a lot of stuff that I continue to do in different that's manifested itself in different ways over my entire last like two decades, really kind of started down there. So it was a special breeding ground.
Dude, it was. And I feel like it's just, it's responsible for the careers of so many people. Those basement shows.
Yeah.
Something of legend. It was like the your Christmas. It was like Christmas for me. I'm like, oh, it's a basement show this week.
Yeah. There was probably only like maybe what, five of them ever. And people probably still come up to me that like, who I'll be like at the Meyer in Jeffersonville and someone will come up and be like, Ryan Davis, I was at your parents' basement in 2002. I met my wife there and I was like, cool, man. Well, dude, have a good day.
You should, you
like
should
put, Fight Club or something.
Man, I read a book called, Under the Big Black Sun. And it was like the story of, like punk in like the late 70s in like LA.
Yeah, it was like X and stuff.
Yeah, exactly. Are you familiar with that book? It's like X and Black Flag.
Yeah,
and the
I've not and, read it, but I've like seen it. I've seen it around.
Yeah, it's it was an awesome book, but it was like basically it's like it tells the tale of like all these punk bands that kind of just like manifest out of like the like they all lived in the same kind of apartment complex that was like a shithole, and then they played like these same like little shithole venues and stuff.
Yeah.
There needs to be like just some sort of book or something put together. Yeah, from
like
the basement
a family
shows.
Tree. Like it all started with these three bands and it branched out into all these other.
We'll just start soliciting people to write their chapters of yeah. like the basement show days of the Southern Indiana scene in the early 2000s.
Remember that band that they were kind of like a big pop punk band and the drummer died? And they played my basement and they left a bunch of merch there. Bayside. Remember that?
Bayside. Yeah.
The guy later went on to be, they were kind of like a big band in those circles. And they, I remember they like left all this merch at my house for some reason. Like just a few years ago, I was cleaning out my bedroom and I found like a bag full of Bayside pins. I just threw them in the trash. It's like, I don't know what I need these for.
Oddly enough, they played Warped Tour the same year we did in 2014. So really? I like got to know a lot of those dudes or whatever.
That's funny.
And I was just like, dude, do you guys remember? Like, I even asked them, I was like, dude, do you remember playing like a basement show? And they're like, oh, yeah. And I was like, yeah,
that's cool.
I was randomly there.
That's
you know?
Cool. I mean, they probably like, I feel like they probably didn't play a lot of stuff like that at that time. They were a little bit bigger, and maybe just because they knew Whiteman and those guys, they like played the basement because they thought it'd be a fun show. I don't know.
And it was. Yeah. And like Asking Autumn. Remember Asking Autumn? I think they're from
Who
Indy.
Was that? Vaguely.
They're from Indy. And dude, there were so many awesome, just like great times there. And yeah. I remember you had a 3DO.
I remember, yeah, I was one of the only people that I've met to this day that had a 3DO. I also remember the first show I guess I ever played was when we were playing and we did a No Doubt cover. Remember that? We did I'm Just a Girl, I think.
Yeah, remember that time we were going to do that Misfits cover? And it was like, Mommy, can you? It was like, Mommy, can I go out and kill tonight? But you're like, Mommy, bring me some cookies.
Yeah.
But dude, everything came from that basement. Like we were just, you know, we're writing our first songs. Like I'd never been in a band at that point that actually had a singer.
Yeah.
And back in the day, like nobody had a PA. How funny is that? Like nobody like had a PA that was like.
Yeah, we had like a little karaoke machine.
Ever loud enough, ever.
With a cassette deck in it and like a like an 8-inch speaker. And that's, I think, what we sang out of. Or maybe we sang out of like a practice.
Maybe like a bass amp or something like that. But yeah, yeah, everything kind of came out of that basement, and like the first songs that we wrote, and like the first time I ever recorded anything was yeah. with Two for Flinching.
Oh, what a feeling to like look back or to listen to something that you've recorded for like the first time. You know, that's like such a crazy feeling. Like, I mean, you know, like you grow up like singing into like cassette recorders or something, but to like hear like an actual like band recording played back to you. I mean, it's so easy now, but back then it was a little bit more difficult.
Yeah. And we had, thank God for Chris Browder. Yeah. Who made that happen for us. And when I actually talked to Browder on the podcast,
yeah, I listened to that
some episodes ago, guys, you can, dig into the vault and check that out. But, he was telling me, he's like, yeah, I remember you guys went to Arby's and then I just had to go back and re-record the guitar parts while you were eating at Arby's.
I don't want to say anything bad about Chris Linhart, but I do remember that like that happening. And then to this day, anytime I'm in like a studio and that like somebody like kind of like fucks up a part, like, oh dude, you're gonna get Linharted if you don't re-record.
Oh man, guys, this isn't just the Two for Flinching podcast. This is also the Sean versus Wild podcast. Thanks so much for joining us again. And in the Smithsonian today, a blast from the past, man. I'm so excited to reconnect. I'm talking to Ryan Davis, Ryan, how are you, sir?
I'm doing great. Thanks for having me over here on this dreary fall, first day of fall.
Yeah, dude. You guys know Ryan, Sophomore Lounge, Cropped Out Fest, and his band State Champion. So you're doing a bunch of stuff these days, man.
I am, yeah. Staying busy with all of it. Always kind of tell myself, like, this is going to be a year where I kind of pump the brakes and just enjoy life a little more, and then it somehow ends up getting crazier and crazier, but that's how I like it. Never a dull moment.
Yeah, dude. And that's kind of how I get as well, is like, sometimes I just get so motivated. I'm like, I'm just going to do more and more and more and more every single year.
Yeah.
And then sometimes I'm like, man, I'm just going to take a nap one day.
Yeah. I think about that. Like, I'm just like, I fantasize about having a year where I just watch a bunch of movies and read a bunch of books and just make drawings and like, don't really talk to anybody and just kind of zone out. And then like, recuperate and then maybe go do a bunch of more things after that, but I just never really find the time to pause.
Yeah, it's like, hey, I'm gonna clear out this Netflix queue.
Yeah.
Which is just, to me, just an ongoing list of things I'll probably never get to.
Well, that, and I, like, for a long time, for years, and even still to this day, I was working at a friend's like thrift store that he owns, and there's always like all these movies and like VHS tapes and DVDs coming through and books, and I would always be buying them just like, I'm going to watch these or read these eventually. And like, I just have piles of them around the house. I'm like, I got to stop buying stuff until I can like process all the things that I have.
Dude, that's the way I feel too. It's like, I'll just buy a bunch of stuff and then I'm like, well, maybe I should just buy maybe a shelf or something, or
yeah,
because it's just like sitting around boxed up, or it just sits around in general. And then finally I'll just be like, you know what? I think I'm just going to give up on this and just donate it.
Yeah. Again. And then the clutter ends up adding to the stress of your life, 'cause you just don't have anywhere to put anything. And it's a big vicious cycle.
Some people might call me a hoarder, I guess. I like to say I'm an avid collector. If I like something, I want to have all of it.
It doesn't, judging by the looks of your house, it's very organized and clean. I wouldn't think that you'd be a hoarder, but maybe I haven't seen all the rooms in the house. Maybe there's like one with like a dead raccoon in it and a bunch of
dude, the trash. Thing about hoarders is like, let me ask you this. You've watched Hoarders before, right?
I have, but not, just maybe like an episode or two. I know what it is. But
somehow everybody gets their fucking water turned off.
Yeah.
And they start like shitting in bags and then they don't throw it away. And I'm just thinking, man. Like, it's one thing to collect things. It's one thing to buy a bunch of stuff. And it's one thing to be messy. But why do you always have to have your fucking water off?
Yeah, even to like, for someone to just very cleanly urinate in a Gatorade bottle or something on tour and have it in the van for a couple hours, I'm just kind of like, I wish we could just get that out of here. Like, I can't imagine just having like bags of shit laying around the house.
That's what you should do on tour. Just like, you know what, guys? We're not stopping.
No.
Ever. We're only stopping for gas.
Yeah.
And no bathroom breaks, so...
Even if it takes longer to get the gas, I still don't want you to run in and use the bathroom.
Yeah, we're going to do it in the van.
Yeah.
Just as God intended.
Yeah.
So, yeah, dude. Well, you got a big festival that's coming up, and I feel like we need to be talking about it because I want everybody listening to definitely go and check it out. So, Cropped Out Fest, that's kind of your baby, right? I mean, it's 8 years of Cropped Out here.
Yeah, that's right. It's my baby. I started it with, I don't know if you would have ever met my friend James Artery. He kind of wasn't really in with like our circle as much in high school, but he was one of my best friends growing up, and he and I started it, I guess like just out of college. So that would have been, I think the first one was in 2010, and he was living in New York and I'd been living in Chicago and moved back here, and we started it, and we just kind of wanted to make a festival for basically just for bands that weren't really getting represented by a lot of other festivals, just kind of like weird music stuff that didn't quite fit under like any one category. And we just did one, and we kind of like picked a place that we thought was weird and kind of off the grid, and we did one and we're like, oh, let's do another one and see. And then he ended up doing it for a few years and ended up kind of just bowing out at one point. I had to make the decision to keep it going on my own, and I did. And every year I'm like, I don't know if I'm going to do it again. And then, you know, like I say, I'm just like, I kind of like the challenge of it. It's fun. Like once it's all over, it's a really good feeling. So it's been almost a decade now. It's crazy.
Yeah. 8 years. Celebrating 8 years of Cropped Out Fest.
Yeah. But it's, it's a bunch of different stuff. Like I said, there's punk, noisy punk bands. There's folk bands. There's electronic music. There's free jazz. There's like comedy stuff, like a little bit of everything. And it happens in this big, like, I don't really know. Have you been to the American Turners Club? You know that spot where they do the coat check parties and stuff?
I have been down there. I've never been to like one of those parties or anything, but
it's a pretty wild facility. And the American Turners Club, like, I guess the Turners were originally like gymnastics people. So they have this big gym where they do circuses, and there's, you know, bars and swings and all this stuff. And that's kind of like their main thing, but they've branched out. And now they have pool parties, and there's like a kickball field where they have baseball tournaments. There's a dock where boats park. There's a bowling alley. There's all this stuff. And we just rent out the whole place for a week and basically have like one big party with all the bands we know and all the bands we like and can get to come to town.
That's pretty awesome, though. I mean, that's awesome just to show up and see what's going on.
Yeah.
Even if you don't, you might not be familiar with the music or what have you, there's going to be plenty for everybody to do there.
Yeah, that's kind of the idea, is just to come down there, and even if you only like a few of the things you see, at least you learned something new and saw something new. And even people that do listen to a lot of the kind of like, you know, weird, as people would probably say, music that I listen to, even people that know a lot about that kind of stuff come, they're like, I don't know half these bands, and then they end up with leaving with a stack of records of things that they didn't know about beforehand, which is really exciting.
Dude, speaking of stack of records, you got a stack of records waiting on you back at the old basement.
I do, yeah. I was just telling Sean that my band, State Champion, has a new record coming out, and we pressed a lot of them this time. This is our fourth record, and the first three we always pressed 500. But then we were always lucky enough to sell out on tour and stuff, and it was always kind of a pain to repress because it would take just long enough to where the plants would lose the plates, and it was always like, what? Like, I don't know. So this time I was like, let's just press 1,000, and now I've got 1,000 unassembled records that have come in different stages, which is, it's like, it's not, they don't just ship them all to you at once. It's like they ship the jackets and then the vinyl, and then, you know, you get the poly bags and the inserts and the download codes, and it's all this different thing. And you put the sticker on the cover, and you're cutting stuff, and you're just over there. And it's a lot of assembly work. So that's what I'm in the middle of right now. I just happen to be over here in Jeffersonville, like going to assemble some records this send off. So,
yeah. So I didn't know that they all arrived separately. I always just thought like, oh yeah, you just get boxes of vinyl already assembled, already.
Yeah.
Ready.
Well, I mean, yeah, you can. I just, you know, I'm just such like a, I can't let go of my just cheapo punk ethos. I'm like, oh, I can save $75 by spending 4 straight days assembling records. Like, sign me up. Oh, why would I blow money on something like that?
$75. How does the vinyl come? Is it just like on a spindle, like a bunch of
yeah,
blank,
it's like
CDs?
Blank CDs? Yeah, they ship you 1 12-foot-tall spindle. No, they come in boxes of, you know, I don't know. They just come in boxes with the center labels attached and like the white dust sleeves, and then you insert them into the jackets and kind of do all the other stuff separately. But the reason that I'm having to assemble it all is like they're all coming from different companies, whereas like you can go to a one-stop shop where they do all that stuff for you and just ship them. But I got the jackets at a place in California, and the records done at a place in Georgia, and the inserts done here in town. So it's really inconvenient the way I chose to do it, but it all looks and sounds great. So,
but hey guys, let this be a lesson to you. $75 is $75. You know what I'm saying? You can put that towards Cropped Out Fest. You can put
yeah,
that
that's
towards
about the exact amount it would cost to go to a fest. So why would I blow that money?
What other festivals do you go to when you're not going to Cropped Out?
Have you that's been kind of the good? Funny thing is I don't really like festivals that much. I don't hate them, but I've just never been a person that likes like standing out in a field getting sunburned all day and paying $9 for a burrito, a Blue Moon or something. But yeah, I go to some every now and then. I'm actually going to a thing tonight that's kind of cool out at Bernheim Forest. Have you ever been out there down on 65, kind of near Jim Beam? It's mainly just sort of like it's literally a forest, so there's a lot of like scientific research facilities out there and stuff, but every year they do something called Sonic Bernheim, where they'll have like site specific installations and musical performances and stuff out in the woods. So I was going to go to that tonight, but the rain kind of screwed everything up. And now I think it's literally just in like the visitor center, which is a little less exciting, but
dude, and you guys lucked out too, cause it rained all this weekend. It's supposed to rain. I mean, I think they canceled Bourbon and Beyond.
Well, you know, I was talking to my girlfriend before I came over here, and that's the irony of it, is we did it this weekend for years. And then because Bourbon and Beyond started across the street from where we do Cropped Out, randomly like 2 years ago or whatever, and it kind of screwed us over because they rented out all the hotels right there and parking got to be a mess and traffic was bad, and we were like, you know what, we're the little guy, we're not gonna be able to fight them on this and get them to move, so like we'll just move. So we moved to 2 weeks later, and now like they kept the date and they got screwed. Not to say that we couldn't also have the same weather 2 weeks from now, but right. It's kind of funny that like we would have probably gotten rained out,
dude,
too.
I heard too that like there it's like you know, forecasted that it's just going to rain and everything. And so they're like, maybe Louder Than Life will be canceled as well.
Oh man, that would be as much as I like, I mean, I have no dog in the fight with that. Like that's big kind of corporate money, music festival stuff, which is fine. Like I like some of the bands playing, but it's not like, I don't really relate to that, but as a person that does book a festival, like, it does make me feel really bad to see like a festival get rained out, even if it's like some dog shit festival. I don't care about it. Just like, oh man, they work so hard to make that happen.
Yeah. And I'm sure you probably still, you know, like, whoever's going to be at Bourbon Beyond, like fucking Stevie Nicks or whatever. Like, yeah. I'm sure you
Who
still,
I love.
Yeah, I'm sure you guys still pay her. You know what I'm saying?
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Rain or shine.
It happened to some friends of mine. I'm friends with that band White Reaper, and the drummer of my bands is their tour manager. And just recently they had to drive down to Alabama for some festival. You know, it's like probably 7 hours each way. They got down there. It was lightning storms, got rained out. They just made the decision to call it, handed them the check. They got back in the van and drove back. It's just like, oh God. I mean, that's, I guess, cool, but you go all the way. You kind of just want to like rock with your boys.
Yeah,
you don't want to turn around and leave.
Like, I've been in a van for 7 hours.
Yeah.
Let me go cash this paycheck real quick. And then I guess we'll just drive again.
Call
for
it
another
a lousy vacation, I guess.
Yeah, dude. I would at least have stayed the night or something like that.
Yeah. But, so I don't know. Yeah, we'll see. I hope it clears up in time for Cropped Out, but, I just don't know. That's the risk you take. That's why at least some of the performances that Cropped Out are indoors. So we might just have to do some like shuffling around with the scheduling. But
yeah, well, I'm going to manifest sunshine. I'm putting it out in the universe right now.
Do it's the
gonna
rain be, dance.
It's going to be a beautiful weekend, guys. So October 5th and 6th, get down to American Turner's. What is American Turner's Field?
Yeah, American Turner's Club. American Turner's Field. They might even call it Turner's Park. Some people, it's
you
a
know
strange
what?
Place.
Get your ass down there, guys.
Just go. Just Google it. It's
just Google
it's 3125 River Road.
Everybody's got a GPS on their phone, guys. This is, I don't need to walk you through this. I don't need to hold your hand.
I love how like in 2018 you'll be on tour or something and it's still like somebody like really wants to tell you directions. That happens all the time. They're like, all right, now I'm going to tell you what to do. You're going to go down there where the Hardee's was. It's not there anymore, but you can tell it used to be a Hardee's and you're going to take three. You're like, I have a phone. I'll be fine. Unless this is like something that just got like reconstructed last night, I'll be perfectly good.
You're going to go down to the Hardee's. Now it's not a Hardee's anymore, but you can tell by the architectural quirks.
Yeah.
I mean, maybe if it was a Pizza Hut or something, you know, like definitely, you can definitely tell an old Pizza Hut.
I always used to love like Pizza Huts that got turned into other things. That was like one of my favorite things to just spot while driving around. And then I saw that someone made like an entire Tumblr of just images of that.
Really?
Yeah, it's great. Yeah,
I feel like Pizza Huts and old Wendy's, like the Wendy's that used to have like the windows that were like.
Yeah, and Taco Bell's out. Too. Taco Bell's have this sort of like, I don't know what you call that kind of like Mexican architecture, but the little like weird roofs, you know?
Yeah, dude. And now, yeah, you're gonna go down there. It used to be a Wendy's. Now it is strictly
now it's in a like a tax filing business.
It's an H&R Block now. So you're gonna want to go there, take three lefts. I have a phone, dude. I don't need this.
I do
feel that it is you know, on tour, I always used a Garmin. Like, I never used my phone. And, we used to get so much shit. People were like, dude, why do you still have a navigation? Like, why do you still have a Garmin?
It's man,
like,
I love the Garmins. It's funny you bring that up because I just bought a new car, like, 48 hours ago. And the cigarette lighter's messed up, so it's not charging my phone properly. And I was like, man, I always like the Garmins because I feel like they're easier to read. So I ended up just borrowing one and I'm just keeping that in the van. Like, I kind of like it better than looking at the phone all the time. It's
also, too, the big thing for us, like, yeah, I feel like it's like louder and it's easier. And the thing is like, you're not, if shit hits the fan, you don't want to be with a dead phone.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So you're saving your phone battery.
And if you don't have unlimited data, which I don't, that's what I also never understood that about, like how these things, I guess, cause they're preloaded with maps. I never understood like why these things worked and you could drive anywhere and they didn't use the internet at all. But I guess they're just like, it's like in there.
Yeah. They're preloaded. And, you're supposed to be able to like, I guess, buy like yearly,
like updated maps,
updates and stuff.
Yeah, but I bet they stopped making those at a certain point because it just becomes antiquated.
Dude, I used mine. Mine was like a 2008, and I used it up until like 2016, and it worked just fine. But eventually, it just gave out. I'm like, man, I got 8 great years from this.
That's a good ride for something that probably costs like, you know, $100 or something.
Yeah, so big shout out to Garmin, guys.
Garmin, what's up? You can send me your... I'm happy to be a Garmin spokesperson. If you all want to just ship me a box of GPSs, I'll put them to use.
Yeah, everybody, make sure you go to Cropped Out Fest, sponsored by Garmin, October 5th and 6th.
No matter where you're going, you'll never be lost with Garmin.
With Garmin.
I also remember taking road trips, like probably even like some of the earlier tours where you would print out MapQuest directions to every single show you were going to.
Do you remember our one out of town show in Indianapolis?
Yeah, of course. Legendary.
And we legendary.
They still talk about it up there in the drinking holes of Indianapolis.
Of an Emerson Theater. But dude, it was so great because like we just brought all our gear in Wes's truck, just like exposed to the elements.
Yeah.
Everything. And then
and it was like a huge club. I feel like it was like a 600 cap room and there was maybe like 14 people.
Yeah, exactly. Oh man. I just love the thought of being young again.
And then your uncle like came and he felt bad for us because it kind of sucked. So he gave us like $50 and we thought it was like the coolest thing ever. Yeah, we made money.
Yeah, he got us a hotel. Dude, stay up here at the Motel 6 or whatever.
Yeah.
He got us a room at the Motel 6, which I thought was great. That's big right. Shout out to Uncle Larry.
Uncle Larry, how you doing?
He's still making power moves. He and I go to concerts and stuff all the time.
Nice. I remember he was into Radiohead, which I thought was cool.
We just went and saw Radiohead. That's like, awesome. Last month.
I've never seen Radiohead. I'd like to see him.
Oh, dude. They're fantastic.
Where was that? Was it
Cincinnati.
I didn't even know they were on tour.
Yeah, dude.
Far back from the mic.
It was awesome. I definitely suggest you give it a whirl. If you have the means, I highly suggest you check it out.
Yeah, it's on my list. What were we talking about before Garmin?
Garmin.
I guess just cropped out. Yeah, I also wanted to say that there's a kickoff and closing. There's kickoff and closing parties that are free if you want to just kind of get your feet wet and not pay the full admission. At Knock Bar on Thursday, October 4th, there's some bands playing, and then at Kaiju on Sunday, and those will both be in the evening around showtime, 7 or 8 or whatever.
I love Kaiju, man. That's an awesome little spot.
It's a good spot. It's like the perfect size room to where if it's kind of a well attended show, it's packed out, and if there's not that many people there, it still doesn't feel too lonely up there on the stage.
They actually just had are you familiar with the dudes from Never Nervous?
Yeah, yeah. And Phil's an old buddy of mine, and I know some of the other guys as well, just from them covering things over the years.
Jake is my cousin. So like he's
Oh crazy, well, I didn't know that.
He's actually my cousin, you know Ryan. So you know cousin Ryan. He's cousin Ryan's cousin. So by default we call ourselves cousins.
Yeah, he's a nice guy. He's a fan of, you know, state champion and stuff. We've talked a little bit at shows.
But Never Nervous and Sean vs. Wild just put together like a wrestling pay-per-view watch party at Kaiju. And they were awesome. So awesome.
Oh, that already happened?
Yeah, it happened a couple weeks ago. We did it for All In. I'm sure you're probably not into wrestling. No one is.
I'm not. I'm like, you know, I'm interested in it from afar. Like I have friends that are into it, but it just... I just never had the attention span to follow the narratives and stuff. I just like, I couldn't ever quite get in.
Dude, Robbie Adelberg.
He was really into it.
Big D'Lo Brown fan. Big shout out to Robbie. I haven't seen
Rob. How you doing, bud?
When was the last time you seen him?
He's sort of elusive. He's still definitely in with my tight group of high school friends, but I don't see him too often. We both kind of keep to ourselves. You ever listen to West Side Gun? You know that rapper?
No, I haven't.
Been really into his stuff lately. He was actually like the one thing I saw at Forecastle. I got a ticket to just to go at 2 p.m. and he played first and I saw him and then left. But he's just one of my favorite modern rap acts, but he's super into wrestling. And like a lot of his imagery and artwork is all based around like Chris Benoit and like all these like kind of like that era wrestling.
The ruthless aggression era.
But and he'll have like samples throughout his music of wrestling stuff. I'll try to send it to you. I think you'd be into it.
Dude, I went down a rabbit hole. Big shout out to Trevor Neely. But I went down a rabbit hole on YouTube of this guy named DJ Cummerbund.
Huh.
And he like does basically mashups of songs, you know?
Yeah.
So the first thing I ever heard of him is like my friend Trevor sent it to me and it was like Rock and Roll All Night, but the actual music was Easy Like Sunday Morning. Like they put it together and like anyway, this guy, like I went down a whole like rabbit hole of listening to his stuff, and everything has like a sample of Macho Man Randy Savage in it at some point
in his like his mixes or whatever.
Yeah, every mix has like a small Macho Man Randy Savage cameo.
Yeah,
in it,
it's like Waldo point. You just gotta like squint and you'll hear it.
Dude, did you ever play the Where's Waldo game for like regular Nintendo or Sega?
I never did. I don't think I remember that one. Was it just like basically the books, but uselessly on an expensive video game?
It was the most difficult thing ever because it was just like the crappiest 8-bit block graphics. So you had to like look for like Waldo, but yeah, it's like
I think that pixel's a mustache. That can't be him. He doesn't have a mustache.
There were like no discernible like sprites that would even be Waldo.
Yeah.
It's like, what am I looking at here? It's like trying to find Waldo in a magic eye.
Yeah. Painting. I saw a funny thing walking down the street. It was just at like a, I don't know, at a salon or a brewery or a coffee house that just like, you know how they have those like little boards out front to get you to come in with clever sayings. And it said, nobody ever asks, how's Waldo? I thought that was fun.
That was great. Dude, big shout out to that brewery big shout out to that sandwich board artist who made that happen.
I thought that was nice.
But dude, so State Champion, your band, State Champion, you'll be busy assembling records, that's for sure. But you've got an album that is coming out.
Yeah, we're putting them together now. Usually in the past, like every time we've had a record come out, it's just been so down to the last minute, like getting them either right before a tour or just missing them so that we didn't even have them in time for a tour, which is a nightmare when you've kind of set up everything to be a record release tour. And actually on our last record, which came out a few years ago, we literally like ran down a UPS truck that we had heard was like in Tennessee with our records on it. Like we had like tracked it and all this stuff. We're like, it says it's in Nashville. We're in Nashville. We should go try to find it. And we like found it and we went and knocked on this truck. And we're like, hey, do you by any chance have these records for Ryan Davis or whatever? And he's like, yeah, I got them. But I technically can't just like hand them to you in the street. I have to like take them somewhere. So we're like, all right, take them to this address. And he like drove 3 blocks and dropped them off at our friend's house. And we like went and got him.
That was awfully nice of that guy. Yeah, I thought for sure he'd be like, no, man, just wait.
No, he was a lifesaver. And we had records for the whole tour because of that. But we were just like, this one, I was like, I don't want to do that again. I'm going to make it like, so I have the records 2 months in advance and can kind of get everything assembled and sent out for press and stuff. So that's the process right now. And then in November, we've got the record coming out. And we're doing like a full East Coast Midwest tour. We're playing Zanzibar. That's like our record release show on November 10th. So if anyone in the area wants to come check that out, it should be a lot of fun.
Well, I'll definitely be there. Dude, Zanzibar is a pretty awesome little venue. Ever since they kind of revamped it and remodeled it.
Yeah, it's nice.
I mean, it was cool back in the day. I remember seeing like the Christensen reunion show there, like before they made it a legit, before they remodeled everything in the back.
Yeah, I like both versions of it. I think I do kind of miss that some of the small shows there were always fun because they were really easy to pack out. But the new one sounds really good and looks good. And Joe really knows what he's doing behind the boards to get it to sound right. And I've never played there with stage. I played there solo once, but not with full band.
I'll tell you what, before we get too deep into it, let's give the listeners a small morsel of State Champion, a small sample of State Champion. You have prepared a piece. You have prepared a song.
Yeah.
So tell me about the song Death Preferences that we'll be listening to.
This is, there's only 7 songs in the record and they're all pretty long. It's like a 42-minute record, so this is one of the longer ones. But they're all a little bit different. This one, I was kind of going for this, like, I don't know, like a mid-70s sort of, like, Blood on the Tracks, Dylan, like, Thin Lizzy ballad kind of vibe with this one, even though I don't think it sounds like either of those things. That's, like, kind of, like, the sound we wanted with it. This woman named Edith Frost from Texas, who's a great songwriter, she's playing piano on it, and yeah, we recorded it up in Bloomington, Indiana, made the whole record up there in the course of a week and just kind of whipped it together and took a while to mix and master and get it all out. But we're really proud of it. Like the song, this is kind of the first single.
Well, I can say I'm lucky enough to have gotten a chance to listen to the whole album before it released, guys. Yeah, that's what happens. Start your own podcast, and you'll be able to get these sort of exclusive perks
of the job. Yeah,
you know what I'm saying. So, but I love it. I thought it turned out awesome, and I'm ready for you guys to hear it, guys. This is Death Preferences by State Champion.
I was coming down at the Diamond Head DMV and the feeling awoke. I remember you and laughter, death preference flapping in a bicycle spoke. I remember you and laughter, sincerity, our final joke. Another screwball comedy afterlife, another enemy turned to smoke. Data mapping assistant, a tripper au pair. You spent the year in a lab coat counting on the paid end of a dare. Making receipt of all the rain checks and misfortunes that you should bear. In case the world should ever audit you. For what is and isn't fair. talking in accent, just to feel like we were part of the team. Walking halos around Choctaw man's proud to see. Mississippi one, Mississippi two, ooh, Mississippi streams roll past the garbage bags. A berries blue and black, and canisters of aerosol cream. Now Cuban leaves and a hundo for patrolling the dock. Did a year with a wrist slap buddy just for trying to lock. Art house led us to the editor, coming back to me by the boss. But the porno sculptor's broken heart is but a product of unmagical thoughts. Mondrian primary post through a trap house grill. Pull a page from the extermination calendar. Leave a note for the Terminex kill. On Mississippi 1, Mississippi 2, miss you lucky you got away when you did. But death preferences, death preferences. Choir is misfiring loops, singing death preferences, ooh, death preferences. It's Saturday night, it's Sunday morning, everybody's smoking weed. Wrapped in Ku Klux linens, I dressed and left so fast that I think my shadow must have been confused for a minute. To be the cock rock band criticized by the art house superintendent. To see your room for the first time, to see a picture of me in it. All my excuses for staying so long, black faced in a duffel. Grab your partner by his or her hand and do the blood font pharmacy shuffle. Another screwball comedy afterlife, another enemy smoked in a brotherly scuffle. I still remember you in laughter when the accent comes back just how we left it. Oh, you know they say that death prefers your baby when you least expect it. And the choirs admire, but the maestro's oh so disrespected. Not a dry seat in the house to be found. Not a dollar off domestic. Death preferences, death preferences. The maestro is too tired to pull rank. Swinging death preferences, ooh, death preferences. It's Saturday night, it's Sunday morning, everybody's parking at the bank. Oh, Mississippi 1, Mississippi 2, I miss you more than you think.
Everybody, that was Death Preferences by State Champion. And Ryan, when I was listening to this yesterday, I was just thinking, you know, in music in 2018, I feel like it's like a lot of times people just have really nothing to say.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's like just a lead up to the chorus. But what I loved about the album is like, dude, the lyrics, the verses, just a lot going on there. You have a lot to say. And yeah. In this day and age, you just don't really get that very often.
Yeah. I mean, that's sort of what, that's like the thing I do, you know? I mean, it's funny thinking about like being in bands, you know, back in high school with you and stuff. My toolbox hasn't really changed much since then. Like I never really was very good on a guitar or an instrument, but like just writing words and kind of constructing little paragraphs that turn into verses and choruses and stuff. That's just kind of like what I've tried to get stronger and stronger at over the years. And I feel like I'm in a pretty good place with it now. I'm really happy with how it all turned out on this record.
It's got a really nice production quality, because you're saying too, like you want a 70s kind of vibe in some of this stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But like some of these songs, I'm like, dude, they're just like perfectly imperfect. It's mm-hmm. got a great human element to it, which is also missing from music. I feel like everything is just corrected down to the most minuscule T.
Well, this one, it's the first one we ever did in like a studio. We've always like, we made one with Browder at his parents' house, and we made one in like an attic in Chicago, and then we made one out in a farmhouse in Shelbyville. And this is the first one where we actually went to like a recording studio, and we recorded it on like a 2-inch tape, like an analog tape, which is that kind of like warm sound it has to it. And then we still went to a house and did overdubs and stuff with the vocals, but it does have like, I don't know, it just feels, the quality of it, it feels like you said, like it's still recorded live, so there are those like happy accidents that are happening kind of, but it's also a little bit more like, if you want to say pro sounding than maybe some of our other recordings. I think that's not a bad thing.
Yeah, it's definitely got a pro sound to it, but it's just done in such a way that's like organic.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I love too, like, you know, in this record collection, very few of these records are like new stuff. It's like everything that I loved that is 60s, 70s, 80s, and things like that. And before things got necessarily like just corrected down to the most minute detail.
Yeah.
And it's like organic, and I like that sort of thing.
I mean, I think there's something to say about all different kinds of recording. Like I love Steely Dan and Fleetwood Mac and that sort of stuff, but like that's just, it's one, not what we do, but two, not what we're just like capable of doing. Like we're not even really super tight musicians, but we know how to like do what we do in a way that works. Like, you know, it's not like we know how to play really tight and we're just like trying to do this like ramshackle thing, but like we just don't know how to play any other way, so that's why it comes off that way. But I think, you know, doing it as long as we have, it's been a band for a decade or something, like it just, we kind of have this like unspoken language between each other, like when we're all playing together, we just like can make it happen.
Dude, I love it. Yeah, and like I said, it's perfectly imperfect, and it's also like just the storytelling and the lyrical content, like it takes you on a journey.
Yeah.
I think from beginning to end, it's awesome.
Yeah, they're sort of like abstract narratives, I guess. I get little pieces together that I work on over the years and kind of get little chunks of them and then kind of weave them into these stories. Like I've never really been good at just sitting down and like singing about how my day went, or like singing about my thoughts on the president or something. Like there's like places for all these kinds of songs, but I'm just not capable of that. So I like creating these sort of like fictional webs of narrative and then kind of putting this like easygoing music behind it.
Well, and that's also like the same magic of like somebody like, say, like Bob Dylan,
yeah,
or like Neil Young, or
yeah, or John Prine, or Townes Van Sant. Like a lot of those guys influenced me to make this kind of music, you know, 10, 12 years ago or whenever I started writing these songs.
Are you a big Jeff Buckley fan back in the day, or his father? What's his father's name?
Tim Buckley. You know, admittedly, I've never really listened to a lot of those records. I know I probably should have. I just never really liked Jeff Buckley that much. And then I just never really got into Tim Buckley, maybe because of that. I don't know. Are you a big fan?
Yeah, I love them both. But yeah, like I was getting kind of like a Tim Buckley, Dylan.
Yeah, you're not the first person to mention it. I feel like that's like, I'm like embarrassed that I haven't listened to some of those records, but
don't worry, I'll make you a playlist.
Yeah,
send you home with it.
I love Leonard Cohen. I know like he did that Leonard Cohen song that's kind of more famous than the Cohen version, but yeah, I mean all that stuff, like the 60s, 70s, 80s songwriter stuff. And you know, I mean, you know me, I listened a little bit of everything, and I think there's little hints even in these like sort of loose garage folk songs that you can kind of like, I'll play like a lead part and you're like, oh, that kind of sounds like Black Flag solo in the middle of this random country record or whatever. Like, I don't know.
Dude, it's, yeah, and it's such a great, I think it is kind of like a great mix of styles because it is country-like in nature, which I grew up on country music.
Yeah.
A lot of listeners will know that. I've rehashed that story to death, but also just like it's got a lot of roots in Americana and like it does rock also too. And many, like, I feel like it does have some just like,
yeah, this is the first record we've actually not, I don't think I had a single distortion pedal on the whole record, which is kind of weird because live we are a little bit more of like a loud, not by any means heavy, but we do play pretty loudly and we are a rock band. Whereas on this record, we really try to like dial it back and just like make the songs the focus instead of like the riffs or something. But I think there's a place for both. And, you know, people compare us to all these kind of like 90s, 2000s alt country bands all the time, but like that's just not stuff I ever really had access to. Like, I never really listened to Drive-By Truckers or Lucero or any of those bands. And it's like, I don't have any issue with it. I just never listened to them. The reason that I make these sort of like alternative country songs is because I listened to country music and alternative music for so long that that's just like what was created, you know?
Yeah,
probably the same way that they made that music.
You got me into like Elliott Smith.
So I love Elliott Smith.
So you're the one that got me into Elliott Smith back in the day, and I went on a huge Elliott Smith run.
Yeah, go back and listen to the third song on our new record. It's called When I Come Through. That's totally like when we were making it, like I said, the one was like the Dylan song, like the When I Come Through is like the Elliott Smith song.
Gotcha.
When we were writing it, I was like, oh dude, let's do this like Elliott Smith part.
Dude, I want to give a big shout out. I got to give you a huge praise for being able to fit Jeff Foxworthy into your lyrics.
That's a very popular lyric. Like every show I've played it as, I did a solo tour back in June and people were like, man, that Jeff Foxworthy lyric's so funny.
Well, give the listeners the full lyric so they can, they can love it as well.
Let's see if I can remember it. It's rebel academics with delirious souls, Jeff Foxworthy in a serious role. We're making resumes out of things we'd really rather not screw with. We're making resumes out of things we'd really rather have nothing to do with. I can't remember. Dude, I haven't played that song in a
Jeff
while.
Jeff Foxworthy in a serious role. Big shout out to Jeff Foxworthy.
Yeah, he's still out there.
He's still out
there. I found like a tape of his a couple years ago and I listened to it in my car and it was just so bad. It was so not funny at all.
If you've ever been too drunk to fish.
But I'm sure he's a nice guy.
Yeah, dude. Yeah, Jeff Foxworthy. I heard, yeah, he is doing serious. What if Jeff Foxworthy did just start doing serious roles? They'd be like, oh yeah, dude, they're making a new Joker movie. I heard they're replacing Joaquin Phoenix with Jeff Foxworthy.
Well, you know, Jim Carrey did it. Adam Sandler did it, I think, somewhat successfully. Others have done it. I think it's his turn to get up there and just go for that Oscar.
Show people your range, Foxworthy.
Yeah, come on, man. We've seen the dumb redneck guy. Like, we want to see the complicated noir Foxworthy. Yeah.
Have you seen The Departed 2 starring Jeff Foxworthy?
he plays all characters. It's like The Deuce, you know, with James Franco, but it's just John Foxworthy.
He's a one-man
Jeff
show.
Foxworthy. Yeah.
Jeff Foxworthy just doing, The Departed 2. Gangs of New York Part 2. It's a modern-day twist on Gangs of New York, and Jeff Foxworthy is the leader.
Yeah, I guess Daniel Day-Lewis is now retiring, so I think it's time for a new character, a method actor, to step up and take the reins. I think all eyes are on Foxworthy.
Yeah, Foxworthy is set to star in the new Paul Thomas Anderson film. Yeah. Oh, man, really going to carry that. Let me ask you, too, now, is the record coming out on Sophomore Lounge? Or
it is, and we're co-releasing it with a label out of New England, out of Western Massachusetts, called Feeding Tube Records, and they've done like a little bit of everything. I mean, Sophomore Lounge has done a little bit of everything, but they've like really done everything from kind of like pretty standard, beautiful folk music to just like fucked up voicemail recordings to just like total noise to jazz. And they're kind of like a label I've always looked up to. And they are in cahoots with Gary Panter. I don't know if you know who he is, but he's a visual artist that did all like the set design for the Pee Wee Herman show and stuff. So he's put out, Gary Panter from Pee Wee Herman, and also of his own accord has released his own music on this label, and also has a like an art show that's supposed to be opening there soon.
The Pee Wee's Playhouse, or like the actual stand-up?
No, like the Playhouse, like all like the kind of set design with all those wacky colors and like, you know, the animatronics and stuff. Was a lot of that was his idea.
Well, that's awesome, though. And you know what I love about Sophomore Lounge is the fact that it's still going, because I was around when it started. Like, I feel like, and I haven't talked to you in so long and seen you in so long. It's been maybe a decade since we probably last caught up.
Yeah, probably.
Or better. And Sophomore Lounge was a thing then.
I think it's just rare for, I don't know, for people to really stick it through with things, you know, especially like half-baked ideas, like starting a record label. It's so easy to just say, I'm going to start a record label, I'm going to start a podcast, I'm going to do whatever. But then to like even do it for 5 years, I think is kind of impressive. And I'm not patting myself on the back. I'm just saying it's like really just something I've loved so much doing every step of the way. And I've said this before, but of all the things I do, I think that's the one that I'm like most interested in continuing. Cause I love the process. I love like the curating. I love just like, I mean, I complain about getting all these different elements and having to assemble things and stuff, but I really do like seeing it when it all comes together and you like finally finish packaging and you can hold it in your hand and be like, okay, this is how I wanted this to look. I'm excited to sell this to people or give this to people or whatever. But yeah, it started in 2007. I started the label just to put out the first CD of State Champion demos, and then hanging out with Nick Dittmeyer and those guys, I started putting out their stuff and Browder, and just kind of like snowballed into meeting more and more friends and having more and more people that didn't have a home for their music that I thought I could create that for them. And
where does the name Sophomore Lounge come from, dude?
Sophomore Lounge comes from, it's kind of a funny story. Back at in high school, we had, you know, there was the senior lounge, which was this coveted, like nice room with like microwaves and sofas and refrigerator and stuff. And then there was like the, and I guess this has like been so long ago now, I feel like maybe juniors were allowed in the senior lounge too. But then there was like the frosh lounge, which was like freshman and sophomore, but it was just lame. It was like mainly just freshmen and like a bunch of people we thought were annoying. So we're like, we're going to make the sophomore lounge, because we were high school. Like we were sophomores in high school. We're like, we're going to make the sophomore lounge, and it's just going to be only sophomores that are allowed in there. And we're just going to do whatever the fuck we want. So we found this little athletic closet, like of like a room that people just put their like field hockey sticks and soccer balls and like backpacks between classes. They just threw them in there. It was probably like smaller than this room for sure. I would say maybe it was like 12 by 8 feet or something. And we would just convene there before class and during recess and after school. And Browder had his acoustic guitar in there. And our friend would be like making drawings in there, and we would get together and just kind of like talk shit on teachers and just hang out and just sort of like be this weird little tight-knit group of freaks. I mean, it was a joke, but it also like it kind of like for its, like how long it lasted, which was only a few months, like it really was like this place to just hang out and kind of be your own person. And I just always like looked back on the vibe of that as something that I wanted to like recreate with the label.
Yeah, dude, just a little place to be creative. Do you still talk to any of your collegiate crew? I feel like I ran into Robbie and Cutter are my Facebook friends, and then I ran into Robbie Linker one day at Z-Bar.
Sure, yeah, I see all those guys around. I don't know how much the listeners are gonna care. I could go down and tell you I've seen who I hasn't, but if you want to make for like a really bad podcast, I'm happy to
just
come
gonna,
back.
We're just gonna be like, hey, you remember Eleanor, your Swedish exchange student? Hey, do you remember
all right, I'm gonna spend a solid 15 on what Eleanor, my Swedish exchange student, has been up to lately. She's had a kid, she's living back in Stockholm. She says she has to tell you hello.
Yes, exactly. Listeners, big hello from Stockholm. So I'm going to have one listen from Sweden.
Yeah.
I will know it's Eleanor.
It's like, ting, you have one listener in Stockholm.
From Sweden. But yeah, that's awesome, man. I'm so glad that the label is fucking running strong. That State Champion is going strong.
I should say, I do, you just brought up Cutter, but I do see Cutter like all the time. He's one of my best friends, and he's a big help with Cropped Out to bring that full circle, is that he is kind of in charge of like all the sponsorship stuff. So he is like, when we first started it, we didn't know how to run a festival. We're just like, we're just gonna like book all these bands and just fucking hope it works out. And then eventually we're like, oh, maybe if we got like local sponsors involved, they could kick us a little bit of money and help us promote and all this stuff. So he's a pretty connected guy in town, and he has just been very helpful with like kind of getting people on board to help spread the word and raise some money and stuff. So he's been doing a lot of that. And I was just at his house like this weekend, like painting a giant sign that we're going to put out in the lawn for Cropped Out. And he's just like, he's a guy who's always down to like share his facilities and make things happen.
Well, hey, big shout out to Cutter, and hey, next year send me some paperwork, dude. Maybe I'll be a sponsor for Cropped Out.
That'd be great.
Definitely be able to promote you here, right here on the Sean
as
well,
as we're
doing so right now. And you're doing it for free. Next year, you might be able to do it, and I'll give you guys some money.
Hell
so
yeah.
We'll see how that goes.
Gladly take your money, Sean.
Yes. Living off your Heartland money there, Sean. Mm-hmm. But yeah. What do you guys, what do you have coming up here? Because just as we kind of start to wind down, you've got cropped out 10-5 and 10-6. October 5th and October 6th, guys. Make sure you get down there to American Turner's venue, park, facility.
Yeah.
Just get down there, dude.
Just make up just your own name for it.
Just go where the party is. So get down there on October 5th and 6th, and then definitely pick up a copy, listeners, of Send Flowers by State Champion. That's going to come out November 9th. And you said you have the album release show.
That's happening at Zanzibar on the 10th, so it's the day after the release. It's weird because it's kind of like mid-tour, so we're doing a week of tour, coming back through Louisville for the Zanzibar show, and then continuing on up east. And then I guess at some point by the end of the year, I'm not really sure. My other band, Tropical Trash, has a finished record that's at the plant and is essentially done. I'm just not sure. You know, all these things in this day and age, you don't really just like, you're not supposed to just be like telling every step of the way. I think mainly because it's boring, but also it's good to just make like a press release. And none of that's been come out. None of that's come out yet. And I actually don't know personally when it's coming out, but Tropical Trash, the record's called Southern Indiana Drone Footage. You can find that in stores sooner than later, hopefully. That's a completely different band that's more sort of like the avant-punk noise improv world. Happy to talk about that a different day, but...
We'll have to have you back for part two.
Yeah, exactly.
So, yeah, you got a pretty busy rest of 2018 lined up then.
Yeah, and I'm going out west after the State Champion Tour with some friends, Jay Jail and Emma Ruth Rundle. They're heading out to, they both had records come out and are heading out on a West Coast tour. I'm just going to go along for the ride and help sell merch and stuff. So I'm pretty much booked up through 2018 and looking forward to the next year. I'm not really sure what it holds, but.
Do you get out west a lot?
Not really, no. And in fact, I get out there so rarely that when I do go out there with bands, it's just like never quite as good as I feel like it should be, just because we just haven't built up that web of contacts out there. And I'm just, I don't know. I think I'm just kind of like a Midwest guy, East Coast guy. I like it out there. I like to visit, but.
I love being out there, and I love the people there, and I love the venues and the stops. Like, I feel like the spots are typically good, but the driving six to 8 hours
and it's just brutal. Yeah, I mean, sometimes we've probably driven like 11 or 12 times, and you get up at 6 in the morning and you drive and you get there and you're tired and the show kind of sucks, and it's just like, it's just hard.
And you got to drive through desert. That's the big thing, dude. It's rough on the van.
Yeah, and I went to Europe the last 3 years straight with different bands, and it's kind of like that over there too. Like, you'll have like really mind-blowingly good shows where you're like, oh my god, when I was a kid, if you told me I'd be playing in Croatia to all these people, or Italy or whatever, like, you, I wouldn't have believed you. But then you just have all these like just mind-numbingly boring days of like the drives are actually cool in Europe because it's just so foreign that it's stimulating, but like some of the routing is just bad, and it's you're not making any money, and it's hard. It's kind of like that in the West Coast too, I think.
Well, and listeners, you know, whether you're in Europe or whether you're out west, you could always use a Garmin.
That's right.
You're never lost.
Wherever your dreams lead you, you're never lost with Garmin.
Yeah. And guys, thanks for tuning in to the Sean vs. Wild podcast, sponsored by Garmin. And make sure you go to the Cropped Out Fest, also sponsored by Garmin.
Cropped Out sponsored by MapQuest, actually.
Man, dude, back in the day, though, like you were saying, those archaic times where you had to just like route with a binder filled with MapQuest printed out directions.
I remember when Travis Edwards and I went to Florida once, and we printed out a bunch of MapQuest directions, and you know, you just look away for 1 minute and all of a sudden you miss an exit, and then it's like an hour and a half later you're like, oh shit, did you see that one? I didn't see it. I was sleeping, man. I don't know.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, oh fuck. You have to turn around and go all the way back.
We used to like always when you do on directions, I would always like reset my tripometer.
Yeah.
So I'd be like, all right, in 1.1
mile 16, I know where to go, right at the Hardee's.
Yeah. Right at the old Hardee's. Yeah. But yeah, and also too, you said you just got a new car 48 hours ago. I was really hoping that you would have arrived in your gold Mercedes.
Man, I love that car. Funny story about that car, if we have time.
Plenty.
It's not a long story, but I had that car. You remember that car? I drove it everywhere. I loved driving. Anywhere in high school where like people wanted to go, I'd be like, I'm driving. And I had it into college. I had it for a long time. It had a couple hundred thousand miles on it. And one day, my bandmate, Mikey, and his friends were like, they were like going to go to Iowa, where he's from, for the weekend for something, a show or a party or something. And I was living in Chicago and working. And I was like, dude, just take my car. Like, don't worry about it. So they take it and they're gone for a few days, and they come back and they're like, man, I don't know, it's driving weird. Like, something's up with it. I was like, really? It didn't have any issues. They're like, nah, I don't know, man. Like, should just maybe get it looked at. So I took it in the next week and they're like, yeah, man, there's like the mechanic's like, there's like $600 worth of impact damage here. Like, did you hit a rock or get in a wreck or something? I was like, no. It's like, do you guys know? Like, did you guys hit anything? I'm like, no, I don't know, man. So I was like, oh, weird. And then it was like so old at that point that I couldn't really afford to like fix it. It just seemed like a money pit. And I was like, all right, I guess I'm just going to get rid of this thing. And then fast forward like 2 years later, we were driving through Chicago and we like passed this like median thing. And somebody in the back seat, my friend Max, was like, dude, that's that fucking median that we like ramped Ryan's car off of that one time. And I was like, what? And Mikey's like, no, she doesn't know. I was like, wait, what? And he's like, oh, fuck, we thought you knew. Yeah, we like totally like ramped your car off this median and like permanently destroyed it. I was like, you motherfucker. That was my baby.
You destroyed the Benz,
dude. The Benz, the gold 91 Benz. That thing was so cool.
You know what I would have done if I were you? I would have just driven up to your parents' house and just given it a nice salute, put it put it in neutral
and let it go to sea.
Let it just go straight into the Ohio River.
Man, like, that would have been a fitting farewell for that.
Ramp down that big hill and go straight into the river.
Yeah, that was a beautiful car. But yeah, I just bought this Land Rover over the weekend and I'm already like thinking about selling it. I'm like, I'm just so stressed out about it. I think it's too nice for me. I need to just like go back to having like a crappy American car and I can afford to fix if it breaks.
Treat yourself, man, with a Land Rover.
That was my thought. And then I bought this thing and I was just immediately like, what am I thinking? I can't, this is like my dream car. I don't deserve a dream car right now. I'm broke.
Yes, you do. Just listeners, tell Ryan how much he deserves it. But yeah. And where can people find you online?
Croppedoutmusic.com. That's where you can get tickets and see the lineup. And there's like a video teaser trailer. That's a lot of fun. There's little snippets of the bands that are playing, SophomoreLoungeRecords.com or I think SophomoreLounge.com both take you to the catalog there. And then I would say statechampion.tumblr.com is sort of like our home base for the band. It's pretty useless. Like, you can't listen to the band or know what it sounds like by going there. We don't have a band camp or anything, but we've got a bunch of, a bunch of flyers and pictures of things that you might be able to derive what we're all about by going there. I don't know.
Awesome. Dude, we'll definitely check it out. Listeners, go there and also go to Cropped Outfest October 5th, October 6th. You'll see Garmin will probably be flying airplanes over.
Yeah, they've got some big surprises in the works.
Yeah, planned. So definitely want to go there. And guys, if you like what you heard today, which something tells me you did, you can always like, share, and subscribe. The Sean vs. Wild podcast. It's at seanversuswild.com. It is on iTunes. It's on Spotify. It's on Stitcher. It's on YouTube. It's wherever you like to listen.
It's on
stuff.
3DO.
Dude, it's on 3DO. It's at Spencer's Gifts. I just want to say this. I went to Spencer's Gifts yesterday. I have not been into Spencer's Gifts since I was a kid, but they put a Spencer's Gifts in the Green Tree Mall in Clarksville.
Nice.
And I don't know when they did this. But I have never been in there.
I didn't realize they'd be adding things to the Green Tree Mall at this point. I thought they'd just be like slowly letting it just blow away into the wind.
Right, yeah. We're going to just level it and put like a real mall in here.
Yeah.
We'll put a guitar center there, hopefully. But here's the deal. So I went into Spencer's Gifts and like half of it is like the back half looked like it was all like weird, like erotica,
yeah,
marital aids, if you will.
Yeah.
And then like the front half seemed like it was all like bong stuff.
Yeah, or like shirts that say like... Like, I saw this one, I was there once, and there was a shirt, there was like a, what do you call it, like a pie chart, and at the top it just said, fuck, and then it was like 98% was like, you, and then like 1% was like, this, and the other percent was like, everything. It's like, damn, this is either like the worst shirt, or I think I'm just going to buy this shirt.
Dude, I saw one yesterday, and it was like, Siri, give me a blowjob.
Yeah, and then there's like a whole section, maybe like an eighth of the store that's just like body piercing supplies.
Right,
it's like, man, this place.
This is perfect for piercing your own belly button at home.
Yeah,
when you just don't feel like leaving the house, you can pierce your belly button at home now.
I don't want to say anything too bad about Spencer's because they are a big sponsor for Cropped Out, and they do give us a lot of money, and they're going to be selling belly button rings down there, front and center on October 5th. And
6th. You'll know me. I'll have the shirt that just says Alexa or Siri or whatever it was. How about a blowjob?
Yeah, it's like a blacklight poster of Bob Marley fighting Scarface. And
there's mushrooms everywhere.
There's mushrooms everywhere.
Dude, if you guys need to know, if you want to catch Ryan down there at Cropped Out Fest, just look for the guy with the huge peace frog tattoo on his back. He'll be selling he'll be selling sculptures and devices used for smoking spice.
Yeah, but, I will.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, guys, thanks so much for tuning in. I've had a great time catching up with you, Ryan. I'm so glad that you came back into my life and came back to the Smithsonian.
Sure, anytime. Chat. Thanks, Sean. I'm glad to be here.
Guys, this has been the Sean vs. Wild podcast.
Thank you for listening, DNN.